Greetings, Pathfinders. My name is Byfe here. Today, we're diving back into Mass Effect Andromeda to talk about something very special. The weapons that you'll be wielding as you fight across this new galaxy. From the common but sturdy M8 Avenger, to the recovered weapons of the Remnant, from the reliable Omniblade, to the devastating Krogan Hammer, your arsenal in Andromeda is an extensive one, to say the very least. There's 5 categories of weapons you should know about. Pistols, which include SMGs and other PDW-style weapons, shotguns for close quarters engagements and sniper rifles for those that wish to deal with a threat from distance, assault rifles for dealing with a multitude of targets, or melee weapons for inflicting single target damage at point-blank range. However, in every one of these weapon categories, there are some that will rise above others. In Mass Effect Andromeda, these are N7 weapons. The N7 classification is one synonymous with special forces and the elite arm of humanity's military. N7 weapons are often designed specifically for devastating force, but if a weapon from another culture is found in the field that's particularly effective, it too will receive such a classification. In short, if you need more firepower, you need one of these. Recently, BioWare released the new gameplay trailer series for Mass Effect Andromeda, which showed off several of these powerful pieces of hardware. In this video, I wanted to go over that trailer and several others to pick out these weapons and talk a little bit more about them. For some of them as well, we've got some Mass Effect 3 footage because a few of them have been repeated and have been pulled over from the Milky Way galaxy, and so that's exactly where we're going to start. And I think we're starting with what is arguably the most iconic of them all, the Black Widow. This sniper was originally based off of a Geth weapon built for anti-tank roles or as a weapon to take down particularly hardy targets, such as the Krogan shock troopers and warlords. It was never designed to be fired by humans, and would under most circumstances result in devastating injuries to the operator. Shattered limbs were the most common of these injuries. However, several firms within Citadel Space took this Geth design and improved upon it, dampening the recoil and creating a more widely usable model for galactic consumption. Eventually, the weapon design was picked up by the Human Systems Alliance, who wanted to increase the damage output of the weapon. The solution was to increase the ammunition capacity of the gun from a single shot to 3. To date, this makes the Black Widow one of the most devastating weapons in all of Citadel space, capable of shredding multiple targets with lethal force. All of this comes with some drawback, though. The Widow is an incredibly heavy weapon, putting immense strain on the operator. Having said all this, the weapon's rounds are so devastating that there is almost no target that can survive the full volley of 3 Widow rounds. This one is one to look out for. Next comes a true infiltrator's weapon, the N7 Valiant. Built for rapid deployment and response, the Valiant is one of the Alliance's most advanced designs for a designated marksman's rifle. The Valiant's original field tests were made under harsh survival circumstances on the planet of Kroll-Javen. The 3-round clip is not as powerful as that of the prior mentioned Black Widow, but what it lacks in power, it makes up for in speed. The weapon has significantly improved handling and faster speed reloads than its bulkier Geth counterpart. But what's even more impressive is the fact that the reduced weight allows it to be used more frequently with powers. For some operators, this will make all the difference. A soldier might look only to the inferior damage of the weapon and then put it aside, but an infiltrator might think twice, firing a short, sharp volley of rounds from cloak, reloading for a follow-up burst, and then quickly repositioning under cloak for further engagement opportunities. The weapon also has the major difference of an advanced stabilizing system that lowers the weapon's recoil to make it nearly non-existent. This means that the necessary follow-up shots can be made almost effortlessly. Following this, we have an assault rifle. No more snipers. This is the N7 Valkyrie. But don't make any mistakes. This is still a weapon of precision. There are many weapons kind of like this, because there are many weapons that have iterations on the design of the popular M8 Avenger. The Valkyrie would only see true deployment amongst Alliance forces after the Battle of the Citadel, where the Reaper Sovereign attempted to open a mass relay to allow a galaxy-wide harvest of intelligent life to begin under the Reapers. This rifle is now a standard issue Alliance weapon, issued to most recruits. It is a well-crafted, well-oiled machine capable of powerful and accurate fire at medium to long ranges. This is in part due to the weapon's bullpup design and two-burst firing mechanism, allowing for greater accuracy as the operator steadies the weapon again between bursts. Whilst heavier than most assault rifles, if tinkered with enough, the weapon can become a powerhouse, capable of chewing through shielded opponents with complete ease. Shotguns are next, and it's worth noting that shotguns are often referred to as corridor clearers, but the N7 Crusader is quite different. In the hands of the right soldier, this weapon is one of utterly devastating precision. It often has more in common with a sniper rifle or a DMR as a result. Typical boomsticks will still have the same stopping power, but this weapon's rounds have such a tight choke that it's almost impossible for some people to miss with this weapon. And then there's the point that it actually just gets too accurate. This weapon was modeled off of riot shotgun designs, but the Battle of Torfan, where the Alliance Marines were forced to hold out against an onslaught of ruthless Batarians, was where the Crusader truly proved invaluable. Its stopping power and precision are both a menace in close quarters and at longer ranges where one might expect assault rifles or sniper rifles to really triumph. This versatility, however, is one that does require a great deal of user precision and accuracy to be exploited properly. It's so often the case that an operator is unable to hit a target because the weapon is simply too accurate. However, this does mean that you'll be hard-pressed to find a more deadly weapon. The Crusader has 4 rounds in the clip by default, and it is one of the most powerful shotguns that you will find. Rounds from this weapon can almost only be outpowered by a few, including the infamous M300 Claymore shotgun. On the reverse scale of shotguns, from incredible stopping power to incredible speed, we need to talk about the N7 Piranha. You see, back in the Milky Way, the war with the Reapers required 2 things: interspecies cooperation and weapons capable of beating the variable Reaper forces. The N7 Piranha is a reflection of both of these conditions upon battlefield technology. It's a lighter shotgun with a much wider pellet spread and a faster rate of fire, made for lighter-bodied species such as the Solarians to deal with massive hordes of husks. However, the Andromeda Initiative's elusive backers often work to procure weapon designs before they hit the market or even main military special forces, and so this weapon, made for a war in one galaxy, will be used in the conflicts in an entirely different one. Bringing massive clips of fully automatic fire to bear, this weapon is a force to be reckoned with. Next comes something very special. It's an Asari weapon, an elegant design it would appear. An Asari sword. Little is known about this weapon, but given the elite hunter sects of Asari culture, it's possible that this weapon was made specifically for Asari huntresses, commandos, or even justicars within certain respected circles on Thessia. The weapon appears to be light and fast, ideal for inflicting critical damage upon a single target. But it's unclear at this exact moment in time whether these blades were made with sparring or fencing in mind. However, given the rarity of the weapon and the nature of warfare in the Helios cluster being refined predominantly to ranged weapon fire, this instance of sparring with another swordmaster is unlikely to ever occur. So if you do pick up a sword, be ready to own the battlefield at close quarters and to be a menace to anything that you might come across. And finally, we have the Dawn, a shotgun which is one of the only weapons we know of from the Helios cluster in Andromeda that's become notorious enough and powerful enough to be classified as an N7 weapon. The designs of these Helios cluster weapons are commonly centered around plasma-based projectiles, with slower munition travel times than the hitscan weapons of the Milky Way. The Dawn shotgun looks as though it may be a specialized weapon of the Ket, although this is no more than speculation and conjecture on my own part. One thing we certainly can tell is that the weapon is extremely powerful, providing 2 rounds in the chamber, sure to devastate whichever enemy you might come across. It's worth noting that the heat-seeking nature of these projectiles means that you may be able to bend the blasts around corners. Of course, though, experimentation with all of these new Helios cluster weapons is sure to be the best way to find their true strengths and weaknesses. Regardless, the Darn is a weapon you should look out for. It's probably infamous in the Helios cluster, and it's a weapon we may really want to acquaint ourselves with if we find ourselves lacking for stopping power. That's all that I can say on the front of weapons, but it's worth noting that you can also collect ultra-rare N7 grade armor, including the Deep Space armor and the Helios Juggernaut armor, which are 2 sets revealed in the previous gameplay trailer shown off at the Game Awards hosted by Jeff Keighley. As more of these weapons get revealed, you can be sure that I'll be doing more guides to each one of them. But in the meantime, if you want more Mass Effect Andromeda content, then you can check back here for more videos. I plan on really stepping up the pace for Mass Effect videos, seeing as the release of the game is less than a month away now. It's a very exciting time. If you really never want to miss a video that I make, though, what you can also do, as well as subscribing, is turn on email notifications, hit the bell next to subscribe, and turn email notifications on so that you never miss a video that I upload. And then, also, if you want to support this video, or if you found it entertaining or informative, please feel free to hit the like button and tell me what your favorite N7 weapon of this bunch is so far. But even if you're just viewing this video and passing through, that's quite enough for me, and I'm very thankful. But, in the meantime, my name is Bife. Per audacia ad astra. I'll see you, Starside.